Now we would like to compute the fundamental group of the circle. The basic tool here is, as I have told you, the exponential map r to s1, namely theta going to e power 2 pi I theta. The fact that r is contractible, therefore, if you take any base point little r, pi 1 of r is going to be a single point. Is that easy to see? Any loop based at a single point we have seen is no longer topic inside any interval. Right? We have seen that. So in particular, it is true in R also. So this fact will come to us very, very much useful. But when we go down to S1 and e power I theta, something strange happens, but not too much strange things. So it gives you complete control over what is happening in pi 1 of S1, namely the exponential map. That gives you the control. Okay. So let us first concentrate on what is the big feature of this exponential map. It is a surjective function, and exponential of t1 plus t2 is what? Is exponential of t1 into exponential of t2. So the addition inside R goes to multiplication inside S1. So it's a group homomorphism. What is the kernel? Kernel is determined by 2 pi. Multiples of 2 pi, right? Exponential of t1 is equal to exponential of t2 if t1 minus t2 is an integer, because now I have put theta going to e power 2 pi I, the 2 pi I has been divided, so it is just an integer. All the integers go to the same point, including the zero. Wherever 0 goes to, namely 1, so they all go to the same point. In fact, difference is an integer, the image will be the same. So this is the meaning of exponential of t1 equal to exponential of t2, if and only if t1 minus t2 is an integer. Okay, so these things I have sketched in this diagram. So all the integers I have put a bullet kind of slightly larger points, okay, 0, 1, 2 here, minus 1, minus 2 here, and so on. All of them are going to this bullet here in the circle. I have taken interval, say, 1/4 to 3/4, 1/4 to 3/4, and 1 plus 1/4 to 1 plus 3/4, and so on. What will the image? It will be from this I, you have to trace all the way up to minus I. This is angle pi by 2, this is 3 pi by 2. Okay? Under 1/4 will go to pi by 2 under this map. That is the meaning of this, right? Because I am multiplying by 2 pi. 2 pi I and the real number. So this is the exponential function. It is injective, restricted to any open interval of length less than 1. In particular, 0 to 1 open interval, it's injective. 1 and 0 go to the same point. You take any interval which is of length less than 1, okay, then exponential map is injective, because difference of any two members there is not going to be an integer, that's all. Okay, so this is the property of this function, which will be exploited to the brim. So this lemma says the following: for every point z in S1, the open set exponential inverse of s1 minus z. Throw away one point. How does the inverse look like? It's a disjoint union of intervals. And if you take exponential function restricted to each of these open intervals, it's a homeomorphism on to this s1 minus a single point, no matter what point you throw it. Okay. So what happens? The inverse image of this one single point, which way you have thrown out, it will be all various points. Look at one single point, say r naught, then the next point will be r naught plus 2 pi. Sorry, r naught plus 1, because I have divided by 2 pi, I keep saying 2 pi. And previous point will be r naught minus 1, and r naught minus 2, r naught minus 3, and so on. The difference will be always an integer, where r naught e power 2 pi f r naught is your z. In between these two intervals, from r naught to r naught plus 1, it is an injective mapping onto s1 minus z. Okay, what is this inverse? Inverse is precisely what you call a logarithmic function chosen inside s1 minus z. Log function is not defined on the whole of s1. You throw just one point, it's defined. The complex logarithm of any unit vector has the real part 0. So it's purely imaginary. And you divide by 2 pi I, then what you get is the inverse of this one. Okay? So this is all a little bit of complex analysis. That's all that I am recalling here. All right? But this property is going to be very, very fundamental for us. Okay? An inverse of exponential defined on any sub-arc of S1. Any sub-arc means at least one point should be missing. Then you take any subset of that which is connected. That's a sub-arc. Okay? It's called a branch of the logarithm, if you want to use this terminology. Maximal sub-arcs on which a branch of logarithm is defined, may be defined, are S1 minus Z. As soon as you include the full thing, it is not defined. You throw away one point, it's defined. In what follows, we will use branches of logarithm defined on open arcs, two of them, either throwing one or throwing minus one. If I throw one, I get one arc, okay? It is a very big arc, except one point is whole circle, right? And I take another arc like this, throwing away minus one. So these two things are important for us. We will use them. Okay. So the branches, why I am saying branches? If you choose, say, minus one to zero, that is one branch, open branch. It's the same log, exponential function. That will not work. When you take 0 to 1, that's a different branch. But once you choose the interval of maximum length minus 1, maximum length 1, okay, open interval, there it is a 1-1 mapping, so it has inverse, and that inverse is a branch of the logarithm. All right? So let us do something. The first thing is, start with any connected space. Actually, you would like to have path connected, but connectedness is enough here. Okay? Take two functions, x to r. Okay? Such that when you compose it exponential, they are the same. Okay? Then, there exists an integer n such that f1 of x minus f2 of x is equal to this integer for all x. The difference is given by one single integer. Okay? Look at this one exponential function from r to s1. This just looks like our fundamental problem in the lifting problem. This is the corresponding P from E to B. E is R and B is S1. X is an arbitrary space. We are studying the lifting problems here. This is the first case of that. What this theorem says, what this lemma says is, up to an additive constant, all the lifts are the same. Take any two lifts, F1 and F2, they differ by one single integer, additive integer. Differ. F1 minus F2 is a constant function n. Is the statement clear? Once the statement is clear, the proof will be as easy as it is. Okay? How do you prove? Look at this difference function, g. F1 minus F2. May make sense because they are taking real values. So, difference makes sense. The difference is also continuous. F and g are continuous, if it's continuous. This has the property to take exponential of g. Remember, exponential is a homomorphism from the additive group to multiplicative group. Therefore, exponential of g is exponential of f1 divided by exponential of f2. But they are the same, so it's equal to 1. And this is true for all x. Therefore, exponential of gx is contained in the set of integers. Because exponential of anything is equal to 1 means it must be an integer. This is what we have seen. Right? Therefore, g from x to r is a map which takes only integral values. But x is connected. If you have a connected space, image of a connected space under a continuous map must be connected. So what is a connected subset of Z? Integers, it has to be a single point. And that point is n, some n. So for all x, gx must be one single n. So what we have proved now is that lifts of functions taking values in S1, two functions taking values in R, via the exponential function, they are unique up to additive constant. Now let us look at this proposition, one by one. Let F be a function from I to S1. That is a loop now. I could have denoted it by omega, okay? But I would like to look function theoretic notation here. Take any map from I to S1. Let us take, say, F0 is 1. This is just to standardize, okay? This is not a very essential thing. So it is starting at 1. Then there exists a unique map G from I to R such that the starting point 0, g of 0, is 0 sitting over 1. This 0 is inside R. The 1 is in our S1, okay? So the first one, this one is a value in S1. It's a unit complex number. 0 is 0 and exponential of g is f. So this says that every function from I to S1 can be lifted. Not only that, it can be lifted. You can choose the starting point, whichever integer you want. I have taken it as F0 is equal to 1. Suppose I have got a lift like this. Then what happens to the other lifts? I know by the previous lemma, I have to add an integer and I get it. So whatever integer I add, F0 will be corresponding integer. Suppose I subtract by 1, then G0. G0 can be made into minus n or plus n or any number. Therefore, along with this proposition, it says that any function, any smooth function from I to S1 can be lifted. And there are so many lifts, namely infinitely many lifts. One at each point, one at each integer. So this will be the meaning of this proposition. So we have to do it only for one, namely g0 equal to 0. Okay? Then we are done. Is that clear? Let us begin how we are going to do this, but complete proof we will do next time. Okay? So how are we going to do this? So the previous lemma, the uniqueness follows. This is what I just told you. Okay, there is a unique map. Suppose there is one, then another one will be differing by this one, by an integer, but I have fixed a g0 equal to 0. So that additive integer n must be 0. That means g minus g1 minus g2 is 0. This means g1 is equal to g2. That is the uniqueness. Okay, so we have to show only the existence. So what is the idea of proving existence? What we do is, we will use the connectivity of I, okay, essentially. But we will do it in a little more economic way. Look at all points set inside I, such that there is a G with the property, namely, G0 is 0, and exponential of G is F. Okay. You know that there is only one such G, if at all. So, suppose G is defined up to T, 0 to T. Then you put that T inside Z. So, Z is a subspace of the interval. Obviously, 0 itself is in Z. Right? Because I can take G0 equal to 0 and that's all. E power 0, e exponential of 0 is 1. We know e power 2 pi I 0 is just 1. So this set is non-empty. Okay. In the usual parlor, what we would like to do is that we will show that Z is open and closed. Suppose we do that. Then, because I is connected and Z is non-empty, Z must be the whole of I. If Z is the whole of I, what happens? 0 to T, that T must be taken, can be taken as 1. So, G is defined on the entire of 0, 1. So, that is the solution. So, this is the scheme of proof. This connectivity is used to prove lots of existence theorems like this in topology, more generally. Not for just I, any connected space. That's why we did the first lemma for just connected spaces. But the lifting cannot be done all the time. Okay? For that, I have to use some special property of I. So that we will come to next time. All right. Thank you.